Hello and welcome to review of Nordgard by Shiro Games. Nordgard is a indie kind of city building, not really city building, RTS indie strategy game. It has elements from Age of Empires, Settlers, and all these good old RTS games from the past. It's actually surprisingly awesome. It's a recent game to Early Access, so it's an Early Access title. But for an Early Access title, it's actually really polished and very nice. I've had a few crashes and a few bugs here and there, but in general, it's been a very, very, very solid and a really nice experience so far. Currently, it has no campaign, but it's coming soon, as it says. Also, multiplayer is coming soon. So what we have in the launch only is a single player. But the maps are always randomly generated, so basically you have infinite replayability through the single player already. And in the single player you can choose from 0 to 3 opponents, so you can just try to get one of the victory goals without any players. You can also have up to 3 opponents currently. I would imagine maybe later we can have bigger maps as well with more opponents. Then you have easy, normal and hard difficulties. I've been playing normal and harder. Hard is not that much harder than the normal, in my opinion. It seems to mostly affect, at least slightly maybe, the AI of the opponent. It's not still most clever AI ever. As usually in RTS games, player is much more intelligent than the AI and can be kind of abused. But it's definitely a small step up between the difficulties. And also the enemies on the map, there's these neutral enemies. Wolves and undead and things, and they are much more. There's a lot more of them, and they are a bit more aggressive on the harder difficulty. Let's choose blue, blue this time, and then we get to the clan selection. So there is currently 2 coming soon, and 3 available, and hopefully, eventually, as the game keeps progressing, there will be more and more and more, because these are kind of flavorful and really awesome. So we have a Fenrir, the clan of the wolf here, who's surprisingly very aggressive, and they get a bonus to your they start with a bonus to warrior's attacks from the weaponsmith, but you can, that's the first research you can do if you want to do it. This is quite nice that you can feed more military and they provide more happiness, which is awesome. And then there's a fame system in the game, so you have 2 different fame levels that you can reach at 200 and 500 that give to you different bonuses. The Fenrir gets Assault, which gives you a 20% attack bonus outside your own territory. Very nice. And then a Berserker, who's very slow, but hits like a truck, and it's really scary. And it's also free, which is quite nice. Then you have a Clan of the Stag. They're proud. Legacy of Astonishing Achievements, renowned for honorable and regal manner. They're like this kingly clan of epic fame. And you start with a extra food and wood and crowns, which is the money, or crowns, I guess. And instead of a brewery, you start the Skald Hall, which gives you additional fame. Brewery gives you happiness normally. And then you get high spirits, extra production if you have happiness, and dedication, and you get extra production when you upgrade buildings, which is quite nice also. And then you have the Clan of the Goat, which is actually my favorite of these 3. They are good at surviving in harsh conditions. So they start with 3 sheep. Sheep by themselves reduce your need for firewood in a single territory by 20%, especially in the winter, so it's really nice. And they can be also eaten for food if shit hits the fan. And also your clan eats less food, which is nice. And then you have a feasting bonus, which gives you a bonus to your feast, which I'll explain in a moment. It's just much better for these guys. And free tools, which are basically upgrades for your people, which is also a very good bonus. But let's go with the goats, and I'll show you some of the mechanics. Also, to get some sheep in the beginning, so we'll see those. And as I said, there is a random generation of the maps, which is awesome. I've played on several maps, and they've been very different from each other. So this game is real-time, so I may have to do things and then explain them, so that we don't die. So let's start by building. So down here is your build menu, and you have all of these buildings. They're the same for everyone. There's upgraded versions of them. Plus, there's a couple of different special buildings for different ones. So let me just plop down a house over there. And I'm gonna plop down a scout camp. And I'm gonna make a woodcutter and explain those. So house is basically housing space for your population. You have five maximum at the start, and each house gives you more. And you can upgrade the houses to give them even more. Then you have a scout camp, which allows you to make scouts for scouting areas. And woodcutters gives you, of course, wood production. Then you have a training camp, which allows you to make your soldiers. Let's make a scout there. And I'll send him to scout there. So instead of having like this fog of war that reveals as you move around, you need to find them territory by territory, or open them. And the territory thing is very important in this game in general, because each territory gives you different things. Then we have a trading post, which gives you money, as you have merchants in there. Fisher's hut, if you're fishing, you can do fish there. Fields, if there's a suitable spot for a field, you can farm there. You have Hunter's Lodge, if there's huntable animals, you can hunt those. Mining, for mining of course. Then defensive towers to shoot enemies. Healer's Hut, which heals your sick and wounded members. Really nice. And the Sheepfold is a special building for these goat people, which allows you to put them sheep into a pasture, which gives you extra food, which is really, really powerful for these guys. And there we revealed another territory. There is actually a farmable tile and some stone in there. You can also press tab to see what each tile has. So there's two building slots, one fish, one weave, and two stone. And that's how many people you can have working in there. Same down here, you start with five slots, this takes one, and then you have wood in there. That's always the same start. Then we have advanced, so you can upgrade buildings, you upgrade your town hall. You get access to these. There's Carvestone to get lore, which is basically research. Food silo, which stores more food. There's a maximum of 500 normally, and then you can have some more. Set in there. Longships allows you to raid for lore or fame and money. Brewery for happiness, or the Skald House for also fame from there. Marketplace allows you to do again money. Trading post allows you to sell items, and this one allows you to buy them, basically, between players. Then you have a forge that allows you to reforge the Sword of Owning. You might want to check that yourself. And then there's Altar of Kings, which is one of the victory conditions of the game. Down here, let's close the building thing. We have our units, so we have our warriors, war chiefs, villagers, woodcutters, farmers, scouts, lore master, smith, brewer, sailor, merchant, miner, fisherman, hunter, healer, and the sheeps. Ah, nice. This actually ends there. Let's send you to scout there. So as I said, these are tiles, and everything is tile-based in this game. And you can buy new tiles with food, you colonize them. If there's no enemies of any kind, you can colonize them. But this is empty, so we'll clean out that for us. We need to also kick the wolf out of there. These are some of the random enemies. There also can be dens of enemies, which keep spawning more and more enemies, and you need to kill them and clear the den. But it also gives you fame, usually, or something, when you do clear them out. So we definitely want to make a farm immediately over there, and we'll send a builder to work on that tile, because they manually work only on that tile where they are. So you can just send them anywhere in the tile, and he will build that, which is quite nice. So the resources in the game are basically the fame, which gets you those two different upgrades you get later on. With the fame, that you can see still up here. What's that? So the feasting and the free tools comes from this. You can see your enemy's fame. You have happiness. So population increases your expected happiness, and they also sometimes want, like, I want better housing, I want better town hall, so they can force you to upgrade things. And getting territory, having army, having breweries and things like that increase your happiness. If you don't have happiness, you cannot grow your population, so it's kind of important if you are looking to get some more population. Food is well, food. You produce it through different means, the farming, fishing, hunting, or just gathering. When you have idle workers in an area where you have a house, they just do this gathering thing here, and they provide food. As you can see, villagers 16 at the moment. Go for working there, and we'll send one in there. This is a very valid strategy, though. It's not like the last resort, but it's actually really good if you have idle people to get food that way. And sometimes in the winter you really want to do that. Just send everyone who is not working already in some kind of food production, like the woodcutters, just send them to become villagers and then just gather food in them. And you can, same way as I send a couple of guys in there to become farmers in the farm, you can just send them into the housing there and it becomes a normal villager, not a town hall. Then we have wood, which is basically the building material, and also you need firewood constantly, depending on their population and everything. And also, there's seasons in the game, so we are currently in the September summer, which means farm is producing more at the moment. And then during winter time, both food production goes down and wood consumption goes up. Then we have money, or the crowns, which basically is just for upkeep and hiring units and building things. And there, one of the wolves is attacking me. So you get these random attacks from animals and things. There's also events in the game where, for example, portals spawn around and they spawn undeads after a while. There's also like earthquakes and many different things that can kind of shake up the game. The blizzard being really, really rough. There's also another farm down here, by the way. This is actually a pretty good start we have on this playthrough. We also have stone and we have iron. Stone is used for building upgrades and iron is used for people upgrades, basically. It's also used to hire a war chief. You can only have one war chief. Let's make a training camp over there. So we'll see what that looks like. Making units is the same. You just send a guy into the training camp, pay 20 gold and he turns into a soldier. And you gotta switch his job back and forth again. But each time you turn him into a warrior, he has to pay the money. Usually 10 stone is required to upgrade a house. Like here, we can upgrade up. And it gives me population growth by 20%, also unlocks extra buildings. And usually, like buildings, the production buildings, when you upgrade them, like this one, it gives you extra production. And then you can have one more guy in there, which is actually really nice. Some of the other things are. Let's make the sheep pasture. Well, we'll wait on that. We'll send another guy to make some wood for me. And we need a house also. Oh, but we don't have any wood, so we'll wait on that. The upgrade for people is here. You click on this and then you select which one you want to upgrade. It's usually like 15% upgrade on their production for that type. Usually it's really good to upgrade your warriors because fighting is kind of big part of Viking game. Surprise, surprise. And the type of a builder or a not a builder, but like if you have a lot of miners or farmers or something, you want to focus on that one and not the ones you don't really have. I guess that makes sense. So there's our construction of the camp done. We'll send one of these idle people there to become a warrior. And we also have enough lore now. So you gain lore passively from population. But there's also like these runestones, scarf stones you can make. There's also this runestone. Directly in here you can send one guy to become a lore master in there. And then there's these stone circles also around everywhere, which allows you to gain lore, which is basically the research points of the games. So you get a research and then you get upgrades to that. And we are into the winter now, so we'll consume more and produce less. So winters are rough, but at the moment we are actually producing enough to be on the positive even during the winter time, which is great. Let's see what's in there. That looks funky. Something is smoking there. And let's take a look at the lore. So there's three different trees in here. It's kind of small, but still quite nice. And you can choose which one you want to upgrade. I usually go for a sharp axes to get more wood early on, and then it goes into cooking masteries and mining. And this is basically usually production or a reduction on the production. Like in here, you get consumption. Like here, firewood consumption goes down by 50 during winter, which is really, really nice. And then you have amenities that gives you extra additional building slot for each area. Really, really powerful also. This one is for military mostly, so weapon damage militia, your civilians hit harder or defend harder, and all kinds of different upgrades from there. And then there is a money making and trading down here, and depending on the victory condition or situation, you wanna kind of mix and match where you go. Also, every time you get 6 of these, or first one comes at 6, you get one blessing, and then you get the second blessing and a third blessing and the fourth blessing, which is the wisdom victory condition. I'm getting attacked by a wolf again. Where's my warrior? Let's send him to fight there. We also found giants, it seems. The Jotun. Ancient creatures from the dark, the Jotun. And we can improve the relations with them, and it's a... You might get some giants to join you. So there's stuff like this in the map, and whoever gets to there first, well, claims it. And there's also a couple different spawns on the map that are victory conditions. There's like the Yggdrasil, the World Tree, who controls that wins the game. There's a portal to Hel, Heimdall, the Belsky portal to Hel, basically. And controlling that also wins you the game. There's a dragon or a wyvern on the map, which gives you fame when you kill it. And there's a all of these funky small things on the map. There's one of those dens, Draugr tombs, where they spawn. And colonizing this gives you fame, which is quite nice. Let's take a look at the victory conditions here. So we see domination, kill all the opposing enemies. Fame, you earn a fame, control enough area, and build Altar of Kings. Yeah, yeah, we'll make house soon for you guys. And then there's a trade option, you earn enough money, you have enough money and in pocket, and then enough merchants. And this is the blessings, the wisdom victory from the lore, and you have enough lore masters, you get this one. And then there's the additional victory conditions when you find the Yggdrasil or whichever you find. And it doesn't show until you see it, which is pretty awesome. And our scout's getting hurt there. And this is pretty much the game. I think we got the Jotnar. Oh, that's the enemy. And the map is actually pretty decent sized, but not too huge. So that you will eventually, fairly quickly, end up next to the enemies, and then you have to kind of fight for the materials and the resources and the tiles you want. Like, there's some really good upgrade tiles here. Very low housing, though. There's also things like these ruins. There's shipwrecks also that you can explore once you take over the region. So I would have to kill these three wolves, take over the region by colonizing, and then we can scout these, and they give different fame, money, materials, and all kinds of things. So they are very nice to get. Let's get a farm going on in there as well. Just boost money. And to which victory condition you go kind of depends a lot on your clan choice. And also, well, of course, like Fenrir is easy to do the conquest victory, just kill everyone, and or domination victory, and you just kill everyone. Done. And also, it depends a lot, like what kind of spawn you happen to get. Like this spawn with the goat people is really good with the farms, and then we have even some wild sheep in there. So if I take control of this region, I'll get sheep for myself. Also, if enemy has sheep. 3 sheep is really, really damn good. If enemy has sheep and you take over their region, you gain their sheep. Also, if there is buildings, first you need to like stand in the area, kill all the enemies, stand in the area, they lose. There's going to be a bar here where they slowly lose their control of the region. And if you then colonize yourself, you get the buildings that are in there. You need to fix them, but you get them. So it's really nice if you can get a border next to an enemy and hit their really nice area and just grab everything they have, their sheep and buildings and everything. And it makes fighting against the AI, and I'm sure when the multiplayer gets to the game, it's gonna be really awesome and really fun poking the enemies. Or players for their materials. Then you can kinda go back and forth. One problem with the game is that it can be really difficult if you see an enemy that's really geared for war, and like a Fenrir clan, the wolf clan, and let's just make you scouts. Oops, I'm just gonna make you into warriors. And they have a lot of units coming your way, There's not much you can do if you haven't prepared for that. But that's pretty much every RTS game for you. And the unit AI is also not the greatest. I can show you quickly here. When they go oi. But you can see that if you keep clicking back and forth, the AI kind of gets funky in there. Not bad, but they don't know what they want to do. You can just kind of do this, and only a couple of them move. And then you can kind of separate them and do all kinds of things like that. Also, you can just send one of your guys back and forth to take the weak ones out of there and not die. But still a pretty damn good RTS game. I've been really surprised how much I like this already in this early access state. And I'm looking so forward to the multiplayer and the single player campaign. It's gonna be awesome. Yeah, that's my quick review of the Northgard. I highly recommend it. It's fairly cheap and it's pretty damn awesome. Of course, you might want to wait for the multiplayer and the campaign to get rolling and see how those go. But even as a single player AI against AI, it's super fun. One run took me about like from hour to 2 hours, depending on how quickly I was rushing for a certain victory or what I was doing. Also depending on the map and what my enemies were doing. So it's fairly quick game, and if you go for all the different victory conditions and play with the different clans and all of that, there's still a pretty decent amount of content. And if you want to do it multiple times, there's infinite maps, as they are randomly generated or procedurally generated. So it's pretty nifty, awesome RTS. But yeah, that's my review. Thank you for watching, and check out other reviews, content, everything on the YouTube channel, and check out the livestream on Nar.tv, where I do live streams of this game and many other builder strategy management games every day. So I'll see you guys next time. Bye bye.